call this meeting to order of the Assiniboia Community Committee for Tuesday, September 13th, 2016. I have with me my council colleagues, Councillor Dobson and Councillor Gillingham. Our esteemed clerk, Ms. Watts, and we have Devin Clark from Planning, and James from Planning, and Rack from Planning. Okay, and so first, can I have a motion, please, regarding the minutes of the July 5th meeting?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
We have no delegations registered.
There are no delegations?
No.
Okay, so let's go to item one. We have just a notice that Ali Sarkowitz has resigned from the Assiniboia Library Advisory Committee. Is that something we need to vote on, Madam Clerk?
Yeah, we're just going to receive it as information.
So, all in favor?
So I need a motion to receive it as information.
I move okay. Receive the report.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Item two is per capita grant for the Charles Wood Historical Society, and I realize it's my word, but I'll just entertain a motion from you, Councillor, to carry it.
Excuse me. I move that the grant, the per capita grant in the amount of $500, be granted as per the request.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried. And next item is number three, Land Dedication Reserve Fund, Stanley Knowles Park. This is in the St. James, Brooklyn, Weston Ward. Councillor Gilliam.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, what this is the Stanley Knowles Park had a plaque on the park when originally it was a bronze plaque, and as unfortunately has been the case throughout the city, bronze plaques and bronze items are going missing, and with the understanding is probably, you know, they're being stolen and taken and salvaged, and people getting money for the value of the bronze. So the bronze plaque designates Stanley Knowles Park. It was a resident alerted us to the fact that it's gone and has been stolen, and requested this that it be replaced. I communicated this with the Parks Department. Parks and Open Space recommend replacing it with an etched black granite stone, which obviously has less salvage value than the bronze. And the good thing is that the public service has a photo of the original bronze plaque, and so the wording, word for word, can be replaced in the new etched black granite. So the cost is considerably less also than a bronze plaque. And so, so Mr. Chair, I would move that the application, the amount of $1,067.85 from the Assiniboia Community Committee be approved to replace this this plaque designation.
Okay, thank you, Councillor. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Next is item number four, traffic study, Ferry Road. This is just a motion to have this receive this information.
Yeah, if I can make a couple of comments on this, Mr. Chair, as well. This report that we have before us is in response to a report that our committee called for back on April the 5th, that the public service be directed to conduct a traffic study on Ferry Road between Portage Avenue and Ness. There have been complaints from residents on Ferry Road about the speed at which vehicles are traveling. It's a 50 kilometer an hour zone there, but you know, probably a lot of people are familiar with Ferry Road. It's a really busy stretch of road, even though there's residential on both sides. The bottom line is, you go through this administrative report. The executive summary report indicates that there are plans to remove the no parking restriction in the southbound lane, because a single southbound lane between Ness and Portage Avenue can adequately accommodate traffic flow. And the reduction in the available traffic lanes is anticipated to have a corresponding effect on vehicle operating speeds. The bottom line is, there are people speeding southbound at the end of the day on the drive home because there's two lanes. And if parking can remain, it'll reduce it to one lane. The report indicates that it can still be maintain acceptable traffic flow performance, even though it's down to one lane. I expect some commuters will be unimpressed with this move, but I support this report for two reasons mainly. The street will become safer for the residents living there, and also for the other and the pedestrians walking in the area, as well as the other cars, people driving in the area. And also will assist the residents as they'll have no parking restrictions on the street. So with that, Mr. Chair, I move the acceptance of this report.
Motion, all in favor?
Aye.
So carried. Great. Now we have item number five, which is 1290 Kenston Boulevard. I'm going to speak to this one for a second, and then I'll just have you make the motion. But this is a really great initiative, and I had the opportunity to meet with the proponent, Mr. Tallman, who I think is here. That's you up there, right? Okay. They are establishing a microbrewery, and we've seen this project many times. This is the building, the 1290 Kenniston, that they completely really changed the face of, and basically are realigning it from, I guess, more of an industrial use to a retail kind of use. And there are a couple of tenants in there, but Mr. Tallman's plan is to put in a microbrewery, which I think is really great. There's a sort of a proliferation of them now in the city, and it's a great industry, and it's good to see these things coming along. So I really wanted this plan to come forward only because the plan is to install a grain silo just in front of the building, and so I had a meeting with Mr. Tallman. He showed me exactly where it's going to be and pretty much what it's going to look like, and I was quite satisfied with that. And you can see actually some of the old pictures. There were silos there before. There's just going to be one, and it's going to supplement the ability for Mr. Tallman's company to make beer on premises. There'll be a serving area as well where people can come and sample the beer, and there'll be some food service and of course production of the beer itself. So I think it's a great idea, and I certainly would entertain a motion to approve the plans. That's what you have. I've seen them all. That's why I'm jumping ahead a little bit. I'm sorry. maybe I should let you guys have a look at them before we have a motion. It's the brewery, tap room, store, Trans Canada. So you might recall this one. There's a barbecue store in here and a dry cleaner. But the very south part, most of the south part of the building, so from about the midway of the building down to Rothwell, will be all the microbrewery. Do we have the interior plans as well?
No.
I think you had them. You don't have them. The interior plans with you? No? Okay. So it's really just to approve the existence and positioning of the silo, which will look pretty much like you see it on the, well, exactly like you see it on the plan here. There's no residential immediately around it. It's just north of the Mercedes dealership. I'm good with that. Do you want to make a motion, or should I pass the chair?
Whichever you prefer. I can. I move approval of the submitted plans as per the recommendation of the administration.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. And next up, we have plan approval for 575 Municipal Road. Mr. Clark, you have the. Plans here?
I do.
I'll pass these around. This is just a plan for a home on Municipal Road. which is the result of the lot subdivision that took place by way of a final approval at one of our first appeals committee hearings just after the election. So I think that's why the final approval has to come forward. I've had a chance to see these plans, and I think they are fine. If you have any questions or questions about it.
Just one, I guess I have one question, Mr. Chair. For our staff, in the report, there's a recommendation. The Urban Planning Division recommends approval of the plans with one condition: plans for fencing on the site as well as additional trees and shrubs be added on site to mitigate the visual impacts of the new dwelling. I don't know if the applicant is aware of that and if there's an openness on their part to accommodate that.
We spoke with them before the meeting today, and they indicated that they would submit plans at some point. We were hoping to actually receive them in advance of the meeting so that we would not need to apply that condition, but we did not. So,
do we have to see that come back then? Or?
Well, we've suggested that could be handled as a director approval, so that we would look for landscaping along the south edge of the property and just verify it on as an administrative approval.
Mr. Chair, as it's in your ward, I don't know if you're good with just the director approval, or if you'd like to take him back.
No, I think it's fine. I'm sure, Mr. Clark, if there was an issue, you would bring it to my attention.
Absolutely.
So, do we have to have a motion that incorporates this condition, or
it's already in the recommendation? So, if you just concur with the
report, and the condition is and as Councillor Gilliam asked, the builder of this home is aware of this.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Just make the motion. It's fine.
Okay. I move the concurrence in the administrative report. The administrative report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Carried. And that is the. Oh, yes, yes.
I move suspension of the rules then to hear an additional report.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. This is the auto body shop one, right?
It's associated with the Mercedes-Benz dealership.
Okay. So this is for lack of a better term, I guess a walk-on board. The proponent, for some reason, the plans didn't get submitted at the right time, and they want to get plan approval before the next community committee meeting. But so this is the first time I'm saying this, but essentially, to put some context in this, so the building we just looked at 1290 with the microbrewery, mm-hmm. This is immediately to the south of it, on off of Rothwell as well.
Oh.
Same side of the street. They'll be neighbors with the
on the other side of Rothwell.
So the guys working at the body shop can go over there for a beer if they want. When they're thirsty. Anyway, so and just immediately to the south of this location is the Mercedes dealership, and so I'm quite enthusiastic about seeing really this corridor filling in so nicely. So it would be 1290 Rothwell, and then this 18,900 square foot auto body shop, and then the Mercedes dealership, all on the east side of Keniston, south of Rothwell, and with the one building being north of Rothwell. I'm not sure why they have the Mercedes-Benz dealership in this. Do you know why?
No, I'm not absolutely sure. We do have someone here that's...
with the lack of registration of delegations, are we allowed to...
You can suspend the rules to Adam, and we can have him certainly come up if you'd like.
I would move suspension of the rules then to accommodate...
And that's Jeff Miller?
Yeah.
Okay, if you want to just come have a seat at the end of the table, Jeff. Thank you.
Is there a picture here of actually how the building is going to... I have to apologize, Mr. Miller. This is the first that we've seen the plan, so I'm learning as I go. But
I believe it's the third page of the. You'll see the elevation, the construction drawing elevations.
Is there actually a picture of how it's going to look?
Well, I believe the rendering is more or less a representation of the design and aesthetic and style of the building. But perhaps Jeff.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, basically the rendering is basically looking at it from 3D from the Mercedes side. So you have your main entrance there. It's going to be very similar to the Mercedes-Benz dealership that's there, just not as much windows. It'll have a Luca Bond out in the front corner, and it'll have a very architectural design series cladding that's going around all around. We have a Luca Bond actually above on windows going around the body shop and areas. So it's not as fancy as the Mercedes, but it's going to look similar to the Mercedes. Pinnacle Auto Body is going to be the one that's not the owner. Rothwell Development Corporation is the owner of the land, and they're going to be in the tenant lease, 15-year lease is my understanding. And basically, Pinnacle Auto Body, they're going to have Mercedes, some symbols of Mercedes on it, but it won't be full Mercedes because they are going to service, besides just Mercedes, other vehicles also.
So then Rothwell is the owner of the whole area, and Mercedes and this other body would be leasing?
Mercedes was subdivided off.
Okay.
Where the Mercedes building was subdivided off, so where Canada Cartage used to be in the back there, it's the same guy, and he subdivided these properties up, but kept ownership of that one property.
But there'll be a similar look, there'll be a complementary look.
Yes, we've designed it to make it match to the Mercedes, but not as fancy, as more to the Mercedes, of course, because that's the dealership, the other one's a body shop, right? But it will look very similar.
Just a planner, were there any issues regarding these plans that you had any concerns about?
We did identify that the landscaping plan is not complete at this point. The applicants do require submission of what's called an alternative equivalent compliance, and that's an opportunity to rearrange the landscaping on site in a manner that effectively fits the design and layout of the development rather than what the bylaw requires. So we still need to go through that process and finalize that.
The freestanding signage, the rooftop signage, and landscaping, those are the things that you're...
There are a few outstanding items in the plan approval that we would still need to review. We have suggested that perhaps this is, again, something that we can review administratively by the director, but if we're more comfortable with it coming back to the community committee, it is something that can be handled at that time as well.
Is Mr. Chair, is that a report that goes with it?
Yes. There's just one copy, sorry.
Okay. I'll pass this around. Just give me a minute to look at it.
The approval is also subject to a variance application.
I was going to ask that question.
Exactly.
Is the board normally have the variances done before we do plan approval?
Yes, normally we try to get that complete before approving the plans. I guess given the timelines, looking to get foundation permits. I guess
any permits without the variance?
No, it's not ideal. We would like to see those variances get approved and finalized as well before they can get foundation permits, but this allows them to at least break ground this year. I believe that is the intent.
Yes.
The next community committee hearing is October 18th, I believe.
When's the variance application coming?
We'll go to the Board of Adjustment on September 21st.
What is the variance for?
There's a number of variances. Reduced yard setbacks. There's an enclosure that requires 25 feet from the yard. It's they're proposing 20 feet. Reduced corner side yard. Basically, it's in keeping with the layout that they're proposing on these site plans. Have the parking lot come fairly close up to the...
When is that hearing?
September 21st.
December 21st?
September
21st. So the idea is to get the plan approval so that they can don't have to come back after to get plan approval after the variances are approved.
Correct.
Which likely will be. They could be appealed, though, in theory.
They could be appealed, right. So if, for whatever reason, the variances are not approved and they are appealed, then the plans as submitted will be nullified and we would have to resubmit.
Okay, so it's all conditional upon the variances anyway.
The variance application actually was applied even previously, but it expired. So basically the same variance has been approved before.
Oh, okay. Also, so you had it at one time.
Yeah, but it expired.
Yes.
So.
And just so I understand, I guess you got a picture of the Mercedes dealership here. So what you're saying is that the style and color of your building will be similar?
Yeah, basically black and gray colors. Yeah. And the Luca, of course, and the Luca Bond will be black too. It's called a Pollock panel. It's very, you know, so like it's very shiny. You see it on a lot of the dealerships. The front entrances are, and it's shiny colors.
Luca?
No, it's just the brand name is Luca. It's a Pollock panel is what it's called.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I have a question. The access road, which is, I guess, on the east side, and it looks like there'll be a driveway in on the south side. Is that right adjacent to the Mercedes?
That access road there is currently right now is in there. It's
yeah, that one. I meant the other one. The one going towards Kennison on the right-hand side.
Going towards, oh, this road there?
No, yeah.
That's not in yet.
No, but that's part of it, and that will connect to the Mercedes dealership so you can drive?
All the way through, yes.
Okay, so that means your properties will be, there won't be any space in between them for any other development?
No, there will not be.
Because that's a big chunk of property we're looking at.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also, like, you know, like, we're this access road right now, there's a ditch there that drains this land. It'll be all tied into the land drainage, so it'll clean up only ditch that'll be on this property after this will be on Rothwell. So there's that, along this access road, there's a drainage ditch. So it's all going to be tied into the land drainage system, so it's going to clean it all up.
Looks like there's some landscaping depicted here in the plan, but are you looking for... more landscaping?
Yeah, there's the bylaw requires a certain amount of landscaping for certain areas, so like street edge landscaping, etc. Right now, we have done a review of what they've submitted, and they're deficient by a few shrubs and trees, so we are hoping to sort of work on that and then finalize it.
And are there any cross-easement agreements required with the Mercedes dealership, or is that a private?
I believe that was handled at the subdivision rezoning stage, where they had to ensure that any access across any sort of properties would be handled under that agreement.
Yeah, there's one running right along the access road there, and 15 foot there. That's where the water line is, a cross easement going across there.
The signage is also. Ian, getting back to the signage, actually.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
So we're going to put this back in the hands of the director, but I should really ask about it because, you know, signage these days can mean a lot of different things. So, like, what are we talking about? Is it going to be, do you have any idea of the signage, or is it?
I believe they've indicated on the site plan, where is it? Sort of at the southwest portion of the site. It says provide power to signage. We don't have any indication as to what that signage is at this time.
Where would it? Oh, right here. I see it. Yeah, so, yeah, that's a logical place for the sign.
Yeah, because
The traffic's coming from the south. That's where people would see it.
Right.
Do you have a sense of what the sign's going to be like?
My understanding from the owner is going to be probably about this high and that way in a directional body shop.
It's going to be
dealership
sign. Like a lit up one? Like a
just a small lit up one. It's not going to be very high. Maybe 6 feet high off the ground.
Okay. All right. Mike can come.
I just have one question. I noticed the in the upper left corner of the pad, which I see the refuse enclosement in the bin. With a body shop, is there any... dangerous goods, as far as, you know, some of the products being used, and what are the rules around the disposal of dangerous goods? Obviously, there's rules around it, but do we have it as far as how those are contained and where those are contained, and is that anticipated on this site? And
that's a good question. I'm not entirely sure. I do know that there are safe handling procedures for oil and you know, disposal of those. As far as enforcement, I don't know. You know, how well we can, you know, oversee and monitor that, but perhaps, I don't know, have you guys considered how that will be handled?
Well, I know that, like, there's no service work going on in there. It's just a body shop, so there's no servicing of vehicles to the oil. I guess if it leaks out because of an accident, but I guess that, but all the vehicles, this is for damaged vehicles, mm-hmm. and it's going to be in a compound. So the most chemicals will be the paint stuff, and I'm sure there's paint regulations, which you got to, it's how to store and remove the paint.
Okay, yeah, I didn't know what quantities there would be as far as it needed to be disposed. I mean, obviously, you'd have to comply, the business has to comply with the regulations, but I just didn't know if we had to make any, in the approval process, if there had to be any allowances given for or thoughts given to the type of approvals granted.
Nothing that I'm aware of, but okay. That's a good point. It's certainly something worth, I'm interested in looking into that.
Okay.
There may be, assuming there are provincial laws also that would have to be complied
there
with.
There would be, I'm sure, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Disposal of different hazardous materials. Okay, well, I'm good to go on this. I'm not really in a mood to pass the chair.
Sure, okay. may I have the report then?
We have funny rules where if I'm chairing a meeting, something's in my ward, I can't make a motion on the item, so sometimes we'll pass the chair and then make a motion, but tonight I'm just asking Councillor Gillian to do that.
Glad to do that. I move, Mr. Chair, concurrence in the recommendations of the administrative report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you.
All right, thanks for your time.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Adjournment?
Yes,
I'll move adjournment.
Adjournment, carried.
We came in here with three tapes.
It's on. Okay, so we're going to just reconvene. This is the community committee meeting for the Assiniboia Community Committee for September 13th, 2016. And I have with me councillors Gillingham and Dobson, and our esteemed clerk, Ms. Watts, our area planner, Mr. Clark, Mr. Jasper, James. Sir James, your last name is escaping me.
Platt.
James Platt. And Rack. Welcome, everybody. And the first item on our agenda this evening is the plan for the Red River Exhibition Lands.
So all persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found in the registration table. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return if he or she so desires and speak in rebuttal. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. This is a copy of the public hearing brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all subdivision and rezoning is digitally recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department at the number listed in the brochure. So item one is a report, which is the plan for Red River Exhibition Parklands, SP 2016. Item two is a public hearing for a subdivision and rezoning at 3977 and 4055 Portage Avenue under file DASZ 33 of 2016. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time, namely, item 3 is a variance at 3977 and 4055 Portage Avenue under file DAV 130922/2016D. So.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. I understand there have been some developments around this file.
Yes.
Mr. Dobson, would you like to speak to that?
Yes, actually I'd like to lay over this file to provide the RM of Henley with additional time to review the material. So item number one, I'd like to lay over until October.
Until the October meeting?
The October Community Committee?
Yes.
Meeting?
Yeah.
Okay. And is that
Can I take that as a motion, Madam?
Correct, for the plan, yeah.
And what would the date of that meeting be?
I believe it's October the 18th. I'll just do a double check. October the 18th.
So all the folks here will know.
Correct.
That. So this matter is being laid over based on Councillor Dobson's motion to the Assiniboia Community Committee meeting of October 18th, 2016. That is the motion. I may have a vote.
Aye.
Carried. It is laid over.
Okay. And then do I reach
items 2 and 3? Yeah. Items 2 and 3, I'd like them to be adjourned until the October 18th Assiniboine Community Committee meeting for the same reasons, to provide the RM of Headingley with additional time to review the material.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried.
Okay. So just so you know, all those who have filled out a public representation form will get official notice that these public hearings have been adjourned to October the 18th. Okay? So we'll just give us a minute to clear this group out to get to the next one.
Second hearing, Madam Cook?
Correct. And just because these individuals were not in the room when we did the first process, I will just quickly do it again. All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing body's recommendation must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return if he or she so desires and speak in rebuttal. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. This is a public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all subdivision and rezoning is digitally recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department with the numbers provided on the brochure. Items 4 and 5. Item 4 is a subdivision and rezoning at 5715 Roblin Boulevard under file DASZ 28 of 2016. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time, namely item 5 is a variance at 5715 Roblin Boulevard under file DAV 119343/2016D. So these are the two applicants, Councillor, that are coming up together.
Okay, we have the applicants, Phil DeLott, Patricia Seniak, if you'd like to come up. Welcome. Can I get you both to state your full names and addresses for our record?
Mine's Patricia Joy Seniak, 5715 Roblin Boulevard, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3R0G8. Sorry, that was my postal code at work.
And Mr. DeLott?
Phil DeLott, 20 Claremont Drive, Niverville. My company name is Bold Zone Incorporated.
And your state of address?
Yeah.
Good. So it's 10 minutes? Okay, you'll have 10 minutes for your presentation. Please proceed.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Phil DeLott. My company is Hold Zone Incorporated. I've been working closely and successfully with the City of Winnipeg and Province of Manitoba to develop much-needed housing in Winnipeg for 35 years. I have always worked in a cooperative manner with the City of Winnipeg departments in order to ensure that we develop viable and sustainable projects that benefit the specific area and the city in general. I'm working with the owners at 5715 Roblin Boulevard to assist them in this town housing development, as well as working in cooperation with any and all city departments that have an interest in ensuring that this housing development is a positive addition to the housing in the area. In that regard, I would like to review the main points of this small but important housing development to the area. I would also like to mention that, having read the planner's report, I believe that it is thorough and comprehensive. Multifamily dwellings in a primarily single-family neighborhood. The subject property falls within the areas of stability policy area of the Complete Community Direction Strategy. Areas of stability will accommodate low to moderate density infill development to support more efficient use of land, infrastructure, and services, as well as enhance housing choice and affordability. Policies in complete communities that broadly apply to site selection and encouragement of a variety of housing types include: encourage intensification to occur at centers and along corridors, focus housing growth to areas that have municipal service capacity to support intensification, in addition to commercial and recreational amenities. Support complete communities by ensuring diverse and high-quality housing stock in order to meet the full life cycle of housing needs within the community, and to promote a mix of housing type and tenure, such as duplexes, low-rise apartments, secondary suites, semi-detached homes, townhouses, and also to provide opportunities to increase multi-model connectivity when development occurs. Examples of multifamily residential uses as well. Some of these examples that are in close proximity to the subject site include 5445 Roblin Boulevard, has 65 units and is 3,015.7 square feet of lot per unit. 10 Shelmerdine Drive has 188 units. The lot area dwelling unit calculation is 3,104.8 square feet per lot. 100-120 Scottwood Drive, fronting directly onto Roblin Boulevard. This development has 74 units on a lot that is approximately 2.87 acres and 1,688 square feet of lot per unit. 4314 Grant Avenue, fronting directly onto Grant Avenue. This development has 50 units and 2,966.7 square feet of lot per unit. By comparison, the proposed development at 5715 Roblin Boulevard is to be 7 units on a lot that is 23,803 square feet. That gives us 3,404.28 square feet. In terms of density, the proposed development is comparable to the developments at 5445 Roblin, 10 Shelmerdine, and 4314 Grant. The proposed development also comparable to some of the existing multifamily developments in the area in that it fronts directly onto the arterial corridor, Grant Avenue, or Roblin Boulevard. Broadly speaking, multifamily residential development is encouraged in communities such as Charleswood in accordance with policies outlined in complete communities, as it can provide diverse and high-quality housing stock. It helps meet the full life cycle of the housing needs and provide opportunity to increase multimodal connectivity when redevelopment occurs. Intensification along corridors is encouraged because, among other benefits, it promotes a form of development that improves walkability to amenities, improves access to transit as a means of transportation, and typically minimizes impact on adjacent lower density houses. Infill. This housing development is an infill development. And we have had extensive discussions with the urban planning division about concerns from the previous proposal, and the applicant has worked with the planning division to address these concerns. Proposed changes include reducing the number of units on site. The applicant submitted a site plan with the current application that proposed 8 units instead of 9 under the previous application. Working with the applicant, the Urban Development Division encouraged the design to incorporate larger yard setbacks from the property line. In doing so, it was determined that removing one of the units from the townhouses along the northern portion of the site would help. As such, the new plan submitted with this application proposed 7 units instead of 9 as per the previous application. This is a very low density situation for this property. Provide additional parking on site. We have reduced the number of units and thus the amount of parking that will be required on site while providing additional visitor parking spaces has been increased to 18 from 11 parking spaces, which includes that includes visitor parking. Providing greater setbacks from the property line. With the reduction of units down to 7, there is sufficient space on site to accommodate greater setbacks than the previous application. With the original submission, yard setbacks were proposed to be 14 feet from the west side and 6 feet from the east side. The plans now indicate that the setback from the west property line will be 16.5 feet and 15.6 feet on the eastern property line. Previous plans also included a variance for a reduced rear yard to allow a 20 feet instead of 25 feet. The site plan has been modified so that this variance is no longer required. In terms of lighting, ensuring that the lighting on site is diffused and orientated to downward in a manner that will not spill over onto adjacent properties. The applicant there's a perceived walkway adjacent to the property and the pumping station, and it is not affected by this development. The lighting on the units will be of no greater height than 10 feet. This landscaping will be incorporated by a professional landscape firm that will, for lack of a better word, isolate this area from the adjacent properties by creating a better buffer. This facility has easy access to transit transportation. Also, this facility meets the guidelines as per the infill guidelines. Okay. We accept the conditions of the approval as per your planning, as per the planning department. And complete communities and give them diverse and high-quality housing and helps meet the full cycle. Okay, I think that's it. I've covered most of the points that I wanted to, and I just wanted to say that we will continue to work in a cooperative manner with the planning department to ensure that this facility meets all of the code and requirements as per the city, and we will work in a cooperative manner. And that's it for my comments.
Okay, thank you, Mr. DeLaw. Just I see Mr. Saniak is here. Could you just state your full name and address for the record?
Tim Senya, 5715 Roman Boulevard.
Okay, and that's Patricia or Tim. Do you have any comments to make in addition to Mr. DeLaw?
No, we don't. I don't.
Okay, councilors, do you have any questions of the applicants at this point in time?
No, I don't have any. I think you've articulated well, so I think we're. I don't have any questions at present. We'll have an opportunity
okay,
to come back, correct?
Yeah, we'll get on with the rest of the presentations, and you'll have an opportunity to come back later. Okay, thank you. All right, in support of the application, we have Alyssa Saniak. Alyssa, would you like to come up and say anything?
You're good?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And we have in support Brian Mansky. Mr. Mansky, are you here? Would you like to speak?
Sure.
Okay, please feel free to come forward. And I'll get you to, again, state your full name and address for the record.
I'm Brian Mansky. My address is 1200 Pembina Highway, Unit 200. That's my office space. I'm the designer of this development, and I've created some additional graphics for the committee. If they would like, I can pass these out to you. A little more description on what we've designed. Okay. And as passed to me, there's some additional letters of support for the project that have been generated. Yeah, they've all been collated, just not stapled. So
three pages left?
Yeah, the three pages each. Yeah, they all end at the legal size paper.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. Jez created these pages for you this afternoon, so they're all pretty fresh. Working very hard to, so we can, as best as possible, give you a good picture as to how the design works with this and how this fits into the property. And on the legal size piece of paper, we're able to transpose our site over top of Google Earth, so we have a very good picture of how it fits in with the immediate neighborhood. So over the last couple of years, we've been working with Tim on the development of this property with quite a number of scenarios as to how to develop it. In the latter stages of development, all our work was done in conjunction with the city planner to provide information that they needed and to fit in with the guidelines they were creating and the needs they were identifying should occur within this property. So this is the final reiteration of the design in the seven units as described, and with all of the setbacks that have increased the separation between these units and any adjacent properties. There is a landscape plan that will be made available that will fill in some of the blank areas that when we lose some trees due to excavation, the replacement trees and other screening trees will be handled through the landscape program that is in place with a landscape architect on this. So what we have here is seven townhouse style units. These units are considered, we consider them three stories in height because we've tucked the garage entirely underneath the building. And your living areas start on the second floor and the upper floor. The heights have been set in accordance with not to exceed the maximum height standard for buildings of this nature in this area. We maintain the proper height for the building. And one other special feature that's contained within this building is we're allowing for personal elevators within every suite. So we didn't have the site space to be able to put bungalow units in here, so we stacked the units up, provided ample space for a personal wheelchair lift. So now that will extend the usability of the building as people move in, and if they wish to stay in the building for a longer period of time, they're able to because the building will be considered totally accessible from the garage level to the top level.
This is this unit here, just near Roblin, that's four.
That's four, and that's three. That's right. Every unit has its primary parking stall is considered the garage. The secondary parking stall is there's a 20-foot driveway in front of the garage. And then we have an additional four visitor stalls identified within the site.
I don't think so. The report and what you explained and what I see here is
Personal elevators, that's kind of an interesting thing. Have you done that before in your design work?
We've proposed them before, but nobody has ever carried through with those designs. So this was very interesting in that when we came into this area and looked at what usage is, a strong proponent of making flexible housing handle many uses. And if you have the ingredients that you want to use within the building up front, you can design it right into the building quite easily. it's very, very hard to retrofit these things in after the fact. So this was something that's been I've been wanting to see occur, and Tim has been gracious enough to say, yes, let's do it. It's a very good idea.
I do have one question. Sure. I just wondered, in the report, and you mentioned as well, you talked about the height of the building, excuse me, given that you can have the garage underneath now and then the living space above that. The report says proposed 32-foot height may be compatible with adequate landscaping to screen the proposed building from adjacent neighbors, and plans should be reviewed with this in mind. Can you explain from your perspective how you'll achieve that?
The height is measured to the middle of the slope of the roof, not to the absolute peak on every building. We've got an 8-foot, the garage is 8 feet tall. We'll have approximately 12 inches for the structure, and a 9-foot living area on the next floor, and 8-foot on the remaining floor, and with 4 and 12 roof slope, we'll come in at around anywhere from 30 to 32 feet height in the middle.
It talks about, though, obviously working with the department, talks about adequate landscaping to screen proposed building from adjacent neighbors. Just want to explain that a little further as well.
This is a heavily treed site in most respects, and the planner has requested additional landscaping over and above the city bylaw requirements for foundation and streetscape landscaping. So in the areas around the parking, we have identified additional planting that we're going to do in that and in some of the corners to give additional trees. When you look at the site plan I have there on the legal side, you'll see how many trees are also available or are sitting there on adjacent properties. So we're going to add to the tree count within this property here to maintain the density of trees to give that degree of screening.
One other question. You mentioned a moment ago, and Councilor Morantz was asking too, in regards to the wheelchair and accessibility. I might have missed it. My apologies. Is it the idea that all 7 suites would be accessible suites?
That's right. Each one has a personal elevator space.
I don't think I have any further questions at this time, Councilor Morantz.
Yeah, they covered material pretty good. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate your presentation. Next, we have a registered in support, Ron Boyce. Ron Boyce here. Please come forward. And I'll get you to state your full name and address for the record, please.
My name is Ron Boyce. I reside in Winnipeg, 78 Dayton Drive.
Please proceed.
Well, I'm actually in support of this particular development. I travel a fair amount across Western Canada and in the States, and I'm to a point right now where I'm looking for kind of a smaller residential retirement home to enjoy and then spend some time down south. We do have a home in the city here. I have a small family I have a large family that's moved out, so it's small now. We've been looking for a place and trying to get into Charleswood for about the last 2 to 3 years, and there is nothing available. It's a great community. I see here there's some quality people here that reside in the area. I feel strongly that 7 additional residences, small homes in this community would be a good addition. It'll add to the tax base. It'll add extra revenue streams to the school systems. And I would like to potentially live in one of these places. I think they're well designed. I've looked at the plans. They're clean. They're attractive. They're less intrusive. They're energy efficient. And I think environmentally progressive and flexible. So. You know, I'd hate to downplay my neighbors here, or my potentially new neighbors, but I think it's a small addition to a great community, and if it was available, I'd like to acquire one. But as it stands right now, there's just nothing in that community right now. Earlier to the comments that came into play, I think it'll help support the services that are in that community. I think as you travel around, you kind of look at these other communities that are doing this type of development across Western Canada. Red Deer's doing it right now. Edmonton's doing it right now. Calgary's doing it right now. Get a little closer to home into Minneapolis and St. Paul. Same sort of structures are being built. Non-intrusive, just small little communities that'll add to the family environment that exists in there today. So, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate your presentation, Mr. Boyce. Next up, we have registered in support, Jackie Wilkie. Jackie Wilkie, would you like to speak? And I'll get you to, just a formality, state your full name and address for the record, please.
Jackie Wilkie with Mayo and Russell Group, 825 St. Joseph. We're the landscape architects on the project. We've been hired to prepare a landscape plan to meet the requirements of the bylaw plus the additional screening for the planner. We have created a plan where we are keeping where we note that we need to keep all of the existing trees and understory, especially protecting those on the east and west properties. We're also proposing to keep four mature trees along Roblin for screening, and adding additional coniferous and deciduous material in on the buffer on the northeast and west sides as required to fill in the holes as was noted, and to provide materials of a similar, trees of a similar a species as is present right now, so that it's in keeping with the tree species there. We have plans for the record for permission. I'm not sure why she clipped everything to boards, but she did. So, well, I'll clip them. We are, with the existing trees being kept on site, we have double the number of trees that are required, and we exceed the requirements. Exceed the requirement for shrubs by three right now in the parking areas. And then the existing understory that's being kept generally doesn't get counted into bylaw calculations, but it is additional screening material at ground level to assist in light and noise attenuation.
All right. Anything further you'd like to say?
That's everything.
So you're just presenting the landscaping plan, yeah, basically. Okay. Councilors, any questions?
Just to make sure I'm understanding the plan, so it looks like, if I'm reading it right, there's a lot of, many of the existing trees, certainly around the perimeter,
mm-hmm,
would remain in place, would be preserved.
Are required to remain in place. Most of them have the trunks that are either near or on the adjacent property, so they need to be preserved.
And then you've got several, many, many trees just on the inner, basically an inner ring for all intents and purposes.
Correct.
That would be planted.
Correct. Well.
That's all I have. Any questions? Thank you.
Also, this one I've got you, like that, there's a lot of existing, except for highly forested lots. Are there plans to sort of mitigate the damage that's going to be done to some of the existing trees on the property?
The are you meaning trees that are meant to be saved and
yeah,
on the property itself? Yeah. There's tree protection protocols that are required by the City of Winnipeg as well that will be followed, and probably a little bit more strenuously, just because it's a private property and we want to make sure that we're keeping the existing trees, as they do have value to the site, especially the ones that are close to Roblin Boulevard, which is the main location for the trees. The trees that are in the middle of the site, existing, will have to go where construction is happening.
Thank you. All right. That's great. Thank you. Next, we're registered in support
Matthew Nicholas. Is not Matthew here? Would you like to speak? Okay, please come forward, and I'll get you to state your full name and address for the record.
I said I had that actually. Okay. I only have three copies, please.
That's okay.
Mm-hmm. My name is Matthew Nicholas. I reside at 215 Darwin Street in Winnipeg, Manitoba. And yeah, no problem.
Oh,
no problem.
Okay. Sorry about that. Please proceed.
Oh, not a problem. Yeah, no, I'm speaking in support of this development. I'm a realtor, first of all, in the city. And one of the reasons I'm speaking in support of this development is because I do see the need for it throughout many areas in the city, including Charleswood, as well as I was contacted by the property owner and the current applicant a few years ago to figure out land value, what a proper development would look like on that property. Then through the process of, consultation with counselors, community consultations, planners, designers, consultants, other realtors, and possible consumers, we developed this plan over a number of years. He also asked me to provide him with important data to help him understand what people were looking for in the area and what the current market conditions were in terms of inventory, supply, pricing, desirable features, and absorption rates. So basically, I'm here to present that information to you so that you guys can understand that the levels of inventory are quite low and there is a demand for this type of product in this neighborhood. I also want to build on what some of the other presenters have said. Like earlier mentioned, I've been involved with this project since 2012, and I've watched the developer work very closely, especially with the city planners, council members, community designers, architects, consultants, realtors, and other stakeholders. And I genuinely think this developer wants to build something that fits into the community and that will benefit the community for the long term. So today I'm going to present some specific points that I believe should be considered when rendering a decision on this application. Infill developments and their importance in mature areas, current market conditions for the area and availability of properties for sale and rent, the unique features of this project that have been designed through feedback from potential purchasers and my market knowledge. I'd first like to highlight the importance of investment and building new residents in mature neighborhoods. As outlined in Plan Winnipeg and the Complete Communities Guide, I agree with these plans and the vision they are trying to accomplish for existing neighborhoods. I've seen these plans in action.
Let's just give me a second.
Sir?
Do you have sir, guard close the door?
Yeah.
Sorry. So I have seen these plans in action through working in many areas of the city. Every time you go into an area and you see this type of investment in renewal of housing stock, you see increased property values, you see people enjoying a larger business community, you see others trying to invest in their community, and you see the current amenities being used to their closer to their potential they were designed for. We also know from feedback from our clients that they feel these neighborhoods that have this type of infill development are more current and more desirable. These investments help create more functional communities, more complete communities, and these investments continue to protect the area's desirability and in turn help protect and raise the value of all properties around them. It's important to understand the current availability and market conditions when considering this application. As a realtor, I have access to statistical data through the Multiple Listing Service and through CMHC. I'm able to pull comprehensive reports on market activity. I also specialize in condominium projects here in the city, as I represent a number of them. I'm asked to consult and help with projects in many areas throughout the city in this capacity. So the first topic that I'd like to address is the land itself. So I've included a map of the adjacent neighborhood where I've marked off 5715 Roblin, which has a pin on it, and then two other X's that shows the general vicinity of two other development sites that could support a project like this. So on the whole Roblin corridor here, there's only essentially three sites left. So again, I feel that it's important to use this site to its highest best use. This property is located in the MLS area 1F, which is the second page of my handout. If you can see there what that area looks like. So this is the neighborhood that we're talking about. Just a note, the MLS system designates neighborhoods by letters and numbers on comparable houses and neighborhood boundaries and geographical restrictions. So as you can see, everything on the north side of Roblin to the river is all part of this neighborhood. So 1F is mostly comprised of medium to large size family homes and lower density multifamily developments, which include rentals and condos. Most of the multifamily developments in this area are 2- and 3-story walk-ups. So currently in the neighborhood 1F, there's only 9 homes actively for sale, 8 of those being single family homes, 1 of them being a condominium. Those current sizes range from 1,050 square feet to 2,900 square feet. And then to give some perspective, there are about 70 homes for sale in the MLS areas of 1F, 1G, and 1H, which makes up most of the Assiniboine Community Committee. This means that only 12% of available homes in the area are available to purchasers in the immediate vicinity of 5715 Roblin, and only 1.4% of those homes are multifamily. In any real estate market, we would consider this very low inventory. I'd also like to address the current rental market conditions, which is stated in page 3 of my handout, page 4, So currently right now, in the whole Assiniboine district, the vacancy rate for 3-bedroom suites is at 0%. There is no 3-bedroom units to rent. Also a note, the only condo sale that is available is only a 2-bedroom unit. So the chance of owning a 3-bedroom condo right now is zero, as well as renting a 3-bedroom suite is zero. You might hear tonight that there is no need for any more development due to there are many places for people to live in the neighborhood, that this neighborhood provides lots of housing choice, that any person can come and enjoy this neighborhood. With the numbers that I've come to with my research, that's just simply not true. If you want to buy a 3-bedroom home in this area, you would have little to no choice. If you're a downsizer who wants to rent a 3-bedroom in this community, you would have little to no choice. You'd have to leave the area. You'd have to move away from your family and friends. Next, we'll step into price ranges, again, which I feel is important to touch on. So the current price range in 1F is between...
So you do know, I'm not sure exactly, and you've done more research on this than I have, but you do know that, I know you've got this Sharpie off there.
Yeah.
That Bridgewood West is, right around the corner.
Yeah, I'm talking about the MLS neighborhoods of 1F, right? So the MLS neighborhoods combine comparable housing units. So Ridgewood would be a new subdivision, so it wouldn't be comparable to an infill development.
It's close. I mean, there are options. Sure. You just said that people would have to...
Yeah, again, though, if you lived and grew up in 1F, right, which is an MLS area, you wouldn't have any opportunity to move into that area.
Okay, for all those 1F people out there, that's good to know.
Yeah, well, again, the 1F it accounts for many houses.
All right.
There's a large number of people that live in that area, as well as 1G, right? So there's also no new developments in 1G, as well as there's only 70 homes for total in sale in those areas, including Ridgewood South.
Okay.
So.
Okay, sorry, just, feel free to proceed.
Yeah, no problem. The current price ranges in this area are between $360,000 and $399,000, further proving that the area is willing and capable of embracing new construction and the costs associated with that. So if the price works in the area, the project design must also fit. Through consultation with market research, we found that a townhouse-style development is more desirable, as people moving to this neighborhood clearly want a little bit more space. They want an outdoor space, as well as they requested a number of trees and natural screening, which the developer has added into his proposal, as well as part of the planner's report. People are also looking for extra parking, whereas, again, 50% more parking is provided than the city bylaw requires. Another important feature is we are close to a major transit route, which is the Roblin Corridor, which gives people availability to downsize their vehicles and reduce their carbon footprint. Our target demographic for this property is in between 30 to 60 years old. They would like to live the maintenance-free lifestyle or the lock-and-leave lifestyle, again, which would be provided. Through that, we've added the request of elevator lifts so that people can age in place and we can reach a larger section of the marketplace. To make sure this project is truly available to as many people as possible, that's why we have the lifts. So we've reached out to realtors and other community and to the community through lead generation websites that we've put forth. We've had people, over 30 people, express interest in possibly buying or renting this size of property. Is specifically to 1F. Okay, through geo-targeting. I hope to have demonstrated that there is a demand for this project, that the project matches the demographic and the style of the area, it matches the price point for the area, and it respects the density of the area. This project fits in.
Do you have anything else you need to be approved on?
No, that's it. That was my evidence.
Okay, thank you for your presentation, Nicholas. Great. All right. Next up, we have... That's him. Is that a K? Is it Mako? Mako? Malayo? Alexandro Baptiste Medeiros?
No, I'm okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
That's Malayo, M-A-L.
Maiko? M-A-I-C-O? Okay. Thank you. Registered in support. Registered in support, we have... Susan and Dennis Stepler, would you like to speak? Just registered in support? Okay, thank you. Next up, we have Jordan Mansky. Mr. Mansky, would you like to? Are you here? Would you like to say anything?
No.
Just registered in support?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Collecting.
Next, we have registered in support Courtney Seniak. Would you? Anything that would you like to say?
Anything?
Courtney.
Yeah, he might just confine him.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, we'll come back to Courtney. Next up, we have. Can you read that? Who's that?
JJ LaBerge.
Registered in support? Okay, thank you. Is Courtney back? No? Okay. Next up, we... Oh, he has to leave? He's registered in support. Okay, good to know. Thank you. All right, next registered in support, we have Gordon Penner. Mr. Penner?
He's with Courtney, and he's in support as well.
He's registered in support? Okay. And Jack LaBerge? LaBerge? Registered in support? Okay, thank you. Carl Prepros? Ross? I'm sure I'm not pronouncing that right.
Prepost.
Registered in support?
Yes.
Okay. 5750. Okay. Chelsea Seniak, registered in support. In support? Okay, great. Anyone else here in support who hasn't filled out a form? Okay. Is that it?
Yep, then we'll move to opposition.
Okay, now to, okay.
Now we're going to person, excuse me.
Okay, I need a, do you have a form?
It's my sister and my brother were on that same form that you told me I had to fill out a different one. So is it Susan and Dennis stuff?
I think I remember seeing that one.
I think, yeah.
They're both on one
Susan
form.
Susan and... Yep, Susan and Dennis Stepler. I do both. So you'll both be registered in support. Okay. Did you want to speak? No. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to move on to people registered in opposition. And the first name I have up is Jan Stewart. Would Jan like to?
Yes.
You're just recorded in opposition? Okay, thank you. Next, we have Rudy Kessen. Mr. Kessen? Would you like to say anything?
Sure.
Okay, please feel free to come forward. I'm going to just, as a formality, have you state your full name and address for the record.
Sure. It's Rudy Kessen, 19 Christopher Cove, in Winnipeg.
If you look to the internet, Charleswood is referred to as unique among Winnipeg's suburban areas and that it retains a semi-rural atmosphere. While looking for a home, residents in the area found one of Charleswood gems, a separate area of the quiet crescent and cul-de-sacs that is removed from commercial and multifamily buildings. This was a very strong reason for many of us to purchase homes in this area. And should we wish to remain in the area as we age, we already have several housing options within walking distance. So for these reasons, as well as others to be mentioned, I'm sure coming up, we're adamantly opposed to any sort of multifamily development in our area. We are against a proposed development approximately 15 years ago on McCallum Crescent. We're against the previous version of this plan last year. And we'll be opposed to any future plans of this type as well. A strong majority of our neighborhood has once again voiced its opposition to this plan. We feel that this majority group of taxpaying citizens should strongly influence a no vote for this plan, rather than one individual who, it should be stated, was also against the previous multifamily plan on McCallum Crescent years ago.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next up we have Debbie Kesson. Would you like to speak? Just registered in opposition. Okay, thank you. And next we have Diane Thompson.
Yes, I'm in opposition.
Just registered in opposition? Okay, thank you. And next we have Jean Wright. So Ms. Wright?
No,
just registered. No comment? Okay. Louise Paz? Paz? Just registered in opposition. Okay, thank you. Marge Christina Barter Cook. Does that sound familiar? Is that you?
In opposition.
Opposition? Any comments? Okay. Sure. Just get you this. When you get up there, state your full name and address for the record.
My name is Marsha Barter Cook, and I just moved into the area very recently, and it's I live right next to Beauchemin Park, and so I've observed many of the people here walking to the park. There's elderly people who walk in the area. There's oftentimes children with their parents who bike, and the more and more people that are building, especially seven units, I have concern about safety as far as traffic. I also have some concerns that I walked in the area where the location where these buildings are going to be built, and the area that I've noticed that the homes are well managed, well taken care of, and the area that where these buildings are going to be built, I think, okay, we hear all these proposals of what it's going to look like, these seven units, and I think this property that where the owners presently reside, they're not being taken care of at present, and so I'm thinking, so they're proposing to build seven units, and so I think what guarantee do we have that they will be maintained over years? I guess that's another one of my concerns. Let me see, I'm just looking at my notes here. The other question I have about the proposals that have been offered today, are these actual renderings? Are they artistic renderings? What guarantees would we have that what is proposed is actually going to happen? A person can come up with all kinds of proposals, but how will it be guaranteed? And let me see. So I have a lot of questions, I guess, and tons of questions, and I've never gone to anything like this before. But I just want to say that I'm definitely in opposition based on what my experience has been so far in the community. Thank you.
Okay, next we have registered opposition, Kathy Ledbrook. Kathy Ledbrook. Okay, perfect. Okay. Just get you to state your full name and address when you get to the front there.
Sure.
First you got to do the full name and address thing, and then you can pass out stuff.
My name is Kathy Ledbrook. I live at 36 McCallum, which is one house over from the property that's going to be subdivided, front yard and backyard.
Welcome. Our clerk will come get your material from you.
Thank you.
This is all one.
Oh, yeah, and maybe you don't want this one here. Yeah, they're just pictures. I'll take this last one. Yeah, and you can have all of those.
Okay, so just one set of everything?
Yeah, there's only one. There's a couple of pictures.
And this is one?
Yeah. The real estate gentleman that spoke before said that we're in dire need of condos. The last time we presented this, I presented you with the condos behind the Legion, the condos, Vasselund, the ones down by the river behind Vasselund. Nobody tonight has mentioned the Grove. They posted it. They listed it. It's three phases. The first phase has been up and running. Only 16 units out of 48 units have sold in the last half a year. It has underground parking. It has its own street. It has traffic lights at the end. It's a perfect spot. If you're going to be a senior citizen, which I am, I'd like underground parking. I'd like to be able to get out onto the street without waiting 15 minutes to get onto Roblin Boulevard. Then we have the Charles. That's all the other condos around that we talked about. The Charles is a street-side development. You're familiar with street-side, which is Qualico Homes. They know what they're doing. Their sign has been posted for more than a year now, and they haven't broken ground yet either. I know that the Grove... it says it does have three bedrooms, or you can use one for a study, whatever you want. 155 Windmill Way. The Charles is right across from the shopping center on Dale Boulevard. Perfect location for it. You've got shopping, you've got doctors, you can go to Unicity, you can go downtown, you've got both bus lines there. 55 Windmill Way. That's just behind No Frills. It was finished about 2 years ago. It still has five units that hasn't sold. Across the street on Scottswood, we have the walkout townhouses. I don't know whether this is a townhouse or a condo. It flips over each week. It depends on who you talk to. There's that huge housing development. On Saturday, when I was going to pick up petitions on Community Road, because they're having lots of problems right now, that's a thoroughfare street that's going to go all the way down to Wilkes. That then will hook up with a new development that's coming down Wilkes this way. People say they have a hard time getting off the street in the morning. This housing development is going to be right at the very end. It sits on the pump house. People are going to have to do a U-turn every morning to get onto Roblin Boulevard. That's also just a couple steps down is where the crosswalk is. That's where the kids cross to go to Beaumont School. And the biggest bone I have with this right now is how does he get permission to cross that pipeline? That pipeline comes down Community Road. That pipeline is going to, I don't know whether it's a pipeline or a water line, whatever you want to call it. It's got a lot of water in it. It's got to hook up with a new development that's coming down Wilkes. Last summer, at the end of our street, it was ripped up all summer. 4 months they were working down there, digging and plowing and whatever they did, I guess they fixed it. What happens if that happens up at the pump house? They're going to have to dig up his driveway because he's landlocked now. He has to come across that major water line, whatever it is. You can easily say, well, the city won't pay to repave his driveway. Well, he's not going to repay $10,000 to repave his driveway. And how I was told that he had permission already. How did he get permission to do something like that? That's city property. That belongs to the water department or whoever. But bottom line is it's taxpayers that are paying for that. These condos have been marketed as everything. They're senior citizens, they're for multifamilies, they're this, they're that. Just by saying you're going to put an elevator in, does anybody know how much an elevator costs? Is an average family going to pay $380,000 for a condo and then spend another $20,000 to put a condo or an elevator in it? We bought our lot. It was one of five lots. We went through a lawyer. We went through our real estate. We even talked to neighbors. It's zoned residential. It's 100% residential. The people in question that are now wanting to sell it, subdivide everything, they were the ones that led the bandwagon on it because they didn't want to see the trees down and they didn't want multifamily. But now, when it's convenient for them, they're selling the rest of the neighbors out. So we did it properly, and we're the ones that are going to suffer from it. You can say that Charleswood needs smaller houses. Charleswood is full of bungalows. There's a million little bungalows in there. And you know what? Being an elderly person and a senior as of this year, I'm going to stay in my bungalow. I'm going to hire somebody to shovel my driveway or cut my lawn when my husband can't do it anymore. We don't have a shortage for elderly people. This is something. I bumped into their daughter on Saturday when she was delivering flyers, and I told her once again, this isn't personal. I don't know these people. I don't dislike them. I don't like them. I just don't know them. It's been done sneakily again. The sign was posted on Roblin. Nobody saw the sign. Somebody saw it in the paper. Then we went looking for the sign. Sure enough, it was there. Nobody on Community Road and nobody in our neighborhood saw it on Grant. He posted it Saturday at 1 o'clock, the picture, the aerial picture. He posted that at 1 o'clock, and at 2 o'clock on Saturday afternoon, his daughter was delivering the flyers. I don't want this to come to the Hatfields and the McCoys in our neighborhood, but there's a lot of people that are really upset over this. There's a lot of people that have a lot to lose by those going in there. If he had been up front with us, maybe everybody could have worked a little together. You can come in and blow fairy dust that you're going to do all kinds of landscaping things. They're not going to plant 38-foot trees. That's impossible. All those trees that they're planning on saving, we spent thousands of dollars in our backyard to save our trees, and they all died because scrub oaks don't like to have their roots tampered with. And then on top of all that, we had to pay a whole lot of money to have them hauled out because they did die on us. I mean, all these people that have come forward and said how wonderful this is, it might be the prettiest condo in the whole world. We just don't want it in our backyard. And I don't think it's fair because we were sold a bill of goods that it was a residential area. There are enough townhouses on Shelmerdine. There are enough condos. We've got them coming out the Yazoo pretty soon. The ones on Scottsdale are two-story ones, and they don't have an elevator. And there's one for sale all the time. There's townhouses down by Safeway, which is just a little farther down the street. There's three of them for sale today. They're always for sale. They're transient people. And all the people that are in support of them are their family and friends. If we were known we could bring our family and friends, we would have brought them tonight. Like, it's easy to say, I think it's a wonderful thing for your neighborhood when you're living in a different part of the city or in Niverville or wherever the heck you're living. It's not fair. It's really and truly not fair that we go about, we take care of our properties, it's investments to us, we cut our lawns, we do all the things you're supposed to do in a neighborhood, and now we're going to be sold out, we're going to be sold a bill of goods. And the one that bothers me is the most, how does he get, he hasn't even thought of what his house is going to look like when he's got two-story on this side, two-story houses on that side, and then he's putting a house to probably be two stories in his backyard. He's landlocked. He's got no sunshine coming in. He'll never see the light of day. So I don't care if he puts a house in his backyard. Let him do what he wants to do there. But that's a single-family dwelling, and that's what our neighborhood is. We're in a very small little pocket. Put a residential house in the front yard. Make it a really nice one and sell it for whatever. But it's not fair. And the trickery is going on again. So there's half of the people, a quarter of the people aren't even here tonight who were opposed to it. So I strongly, and I really do, I oppose all of it. Sorry, thanks.
Thank you very much. Okay, next registered in opposition is Ron Ledbrook. Mr. Ledbrook. Just when you get up front, please state your name and address.
Good evening. My name is Ron Ledbrook, and I reside at 36 McKellen Crescent. That was my wife, Kathy. I'm the guy that shovels the walk and mows the lawn, just for the record. Before I get into my point of views of the opposition of the variance that's going in, I just want to lay on two comments. And number one is you're going to hear tonight a lot of people that are opposed to the variance that's going on, and you may hear some repetitive comments that are going to be presented. I'd ask you that you consider the repetitive comments and not just say, oh, gee, that's already been brought up. I think this indicates the passion that the people in this community in single-family housing has towards the opposition of the variance of putting multifamily housing into the neighborhood. They're dedicated, they're passionate, they worry about the safety of their children, and they are just 100% opposed to the variance that's going on. Second comment I have is when I went around and gathered up some of these oppositions and collated them, I was really upset or set back on the stress level that the people in the neighborhood have been under for the last 3 to 4 years. We've been to community clubs, we've been to legions for the last 3 or 4 years getting the plans and the layout of this development or this variance that's going to be taking place for the last 3 to 4 years. This time around, there was no preliminary indication of what was going to be taken on and what was going to be laid out to us. It was, as Kathy said, it was Saturday at 1 o'clock when the diagram or the block and lot plan went up on the variance sign that's on the lot. It only hit the McCallum side. It didn't hit the Roblin side of the street where people that lived across from the 5715 where reside could not see it. And, you know, we would like at least to have had the proper preliminaries to see exactly what changes were made to this particular adjustment that's taken place. I sent into the city yesterday a list of the people that are opposed, and I think the city has a copy of them. There's 93 householders that are opposed in the area with 181 signatures of different reasons for doing it.
Madam Clerk, do we need to get that copy, or do we have that already?
I think you have a copy. I dropped it off yesterday.
Okay. All right, we have it.
Okay. Now, from my point of views, Kathy and other people have mentioned that 5715 led the opposing multifamily housing in 2002. I own one of those lots, and the people at 5715 led the bandwagon to keep the single-family dwelling housing in our neighborhood. And now it's done a complete 180 and a flip-flop on that. Our neighborhood is turning into a young neighborhood. It cycles through as the older people leave and the younger ones are showing up. We've had a lot of new families move in the last little while with young children. And the only way that these people north of Roblin Boulevard can get their kids to school, which is Beaumont School on the south side of Roblin, is to cross the only people path that is on Roblin Boulevard. And it's 175 meters away from where this entrance to this multifamily housing would be. So it's going to have a lot of impact on the amount of traffic coming out of Roblin or onto Roblin from that particular driveway. And there has, and not in the last little while, thank goodness, but there has been a fatality of a young child that was hit at that crosswalk some times ago. So again, only 175 feet or 175 meters away from that people path with the added traffic that's going to be there. Last meeting we had was in January the 13th of 2015. The application was denied. One of the reasons was that do not believe this development fits within the character of the neighborhood, given that it's bordered on all sides by single-family dwellings. I think dropping two units out of this picture really doesn't change the landscape of what the actual building and the actual construction is going to be from there. Going from 9 units to 7 units, it's still not going to fit the character of the neighborhood that we have there. Also, it was said that was do believe that there is a need in the ward for full cycle housing for the seniors who are aging and would like to stay in the neighborhood. This must be addressed in some fashion. Well, I think it has been addressed in the fashion in that Roblin Grove is a new development that's going right behind Vasalund with traffic lights right on the corner for ease and aggressive of traffic. It is going to be 3 phases. The first phase is 48 units, of which 16 is already sold. Phase 2 and 3 to be developed. It's in an ideal situation. There's a lot of space for the development of this. Behind it is already a seniors apartment block. In front of it is the Vasalund Seniors Home, and right beside it is the Charleswood Senior Center, the Charleswood Nursing Home. So anybody that goes into there, it's a short walk to their next step where they're going to live. Also down on Roblin and Dale, the Charles, a development by Streetside, is going up as well, So there has been some addressing of the need of multifamily or condominiums that are in the area. Also, it seems to disagree with the planner. It seems unlikely for 7 units. Households to the north, east, and south and west are right directly to these places, are the ones that are leading the bandwagon on opposition. And again, I state that we have quite a few people here tonight that are going to list and give us their opposition towards this development.
Thank you.
Any questions?
No, I think you stated it very well.
Thank you.
Okay, next up we have Jennifer Jody Burscheid. Just registered in opposition. Okay, thank you. And registered in opposition, Rob Lips. Rob?
Yes, hello. Hi.
Would you like to speak?
Sure. I wasn't prepared at all.
Okay, great. Just get you to state your name and address.
Yes, my name is Rob Lips. Good evening, everyone. I live on 14 McCallum Crescent, so just down the street from the area in question. I went around some sheets with a couple of neighbors of mine the other day to get people's feedback on this situation. Everybody we spoke to was opposed to it. People said thank you very much for taking the time to do this. A lot of people weren't even aware of it. I myself just found out about this last week. The one last year I had found out just a few days before, so I was a little upset at that. Otherwise, maybe I would have did my homework a little bit more and stuff. And one thing that kind of I find surprising is the people that were in favor of it that came up here tonight were people that don't live in the area. I mean, maybe if I was a realtor or if I was a developer and I had some financial gain, then I would be, you know, in support of this as well. I mean, at my work, they put up a brand new building a few years ago. It gave me tons of work. I was in support of it because it meant more money for me at my job. But it wasn't in my backyard. And at the end of the day, when the time the building was done, there was, of course, things went over budget, and there was things that were left out, things that they said they would do, they didn't do. So, yeah, I would just like to say that Charleswood is my home. All the people that come and visit me, we go for walks in the neighborhood. They say, what a beautiful neighborhood. Everybody loves the area. And I'd like to keep it that way. I thought it was also kind of odd that there was a real estate agent up here saying there's only 9 listings in Charleswood. Maybe that's on the multiple listing, but there's many private sales in Charleswood. There's many condos for sale. If I had more time, I would have maybe brought some evidence of that. But again, I wasn't prepared to do that tonight. So, I'm opposed to this. The increase in traffic, we already have cars that sometimes, you know, that'll speed down the street when there's young kids playing. This would be more traffic. They just redid our streets a few years ago. Now we're talking about having construction equipment come down the street, you know. So I would like to keep the community the way it is, a nice, peaceful, quiet community. And as somebody pointed out, we have Ridgewood West, which is they're building, I believe, at least 1,000 new homes back, you know, in there. It's a perfect place to build condos there, you know. But where we are, they're trying to squeeze it in one little area. And like I say, a lot of people that I spoke to, they just found out about this, and they're opposed to it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, we have Ann Nugent. Ann Nugent, is she here?
My name is Ann Nugent, and I live at 42 McCallum Crescent. That's the property that's just to the west of the proposal. What I'm going to do is just actually read a summary of some of the comments that the people that I talked to and have voiced, and myself have voiced as well. There is a feeling that the applicant is trying to have this request quickly put through with little time given for the neighbors to study the proposed changes. The plan was not posted on the internet until late Friday, September 9th, and the meeting where a decision is being made is being held today, September 13th. This is only 4 days where people can formulate their thoughts. While the uncompleted plan was available on Fort Street, not everyone was able to go down to see that, and this does not allow sufficient time for us to study it. And again, we didn't get to see the landscape plan either. Added to feelings of uneasiness or mistrust is that the applicant had the old variance application posted in his yard for the entire summer. That was the old one from 2015. Perhaps this was an attempt to make it less noticeable when the new request was posted. In regards to Lot 1, while having an additional driveway onto McCallum will reduce parking on the street, this seems to be a reasonable request. With this property having a double garage and the corresponding double driveway, there will be enough room for four vehicles to park off-street. This is in keeping with the single-family neighborhood. In regards to Lot 2, adding another driveway onto McCallum, especially at this location on the curve, has all sorts of concerns. The safety of drivers coming around the curve and pedestrians trying to walk through the city land to the bus, further reduction in street parking due to the additional driveway. Will pedestrians still be able to have access to the city land to cross through to Roblin? And this includes all the children that use that crosswalk to go to school. In the winter, where will the snow from this driveway be shoveled, if shoveled, and will that further restrict access to that pass through to Roblin? Additional cars from this lot will be added to the already reduced amount of available street parking on the adjacent streets. Also, such a large reduction in the front yard from 22 feet to less than 8 seems to be too much. While varying a front yard by 5 to 10% would seem reasonable, does reducing it 64% make sense? What effect will this have to the feel and look of the neighborhood? In regards to Lot 3, multifamily is not in keeping with the feel and the single-family structure of this neighborhood. It'll negatively affect current property values, impact the privacy of adjacent properties, and increase noise levels, and it's just too dense. The townhouses will not have much yard area, which really changes the feel of the neighborhood. Additional noise, where do children play, safety in that area with the many cars in there. And 1,600 to 1,800 square feet will mean families of potentially more than two cars per unit. It's a three-bedroom townhouse you're building. There could be potentially three cars. Where there's only four extra spaces, where are those extra cars going to park? When they have family come over at Christmas time, one family has a family come over. That's the four extra stalls. Where is everyone else going to park? Shelmer Dean already has the co-op going on there. You can't park in Roblin. McCallum is already crowded with parkings. While it is stated there will be two parking spots per unit, this does not guarantee they will be utilized. As the placement of the spots are back-to-back, many people don't want to park in front of the garage door because of the need to move cars around. Four visitor spots are insufficient for seven units. While it is understandable that the applicant would like to subdivide his lot, it should be done in a way that fits the neighborhood. This application seems to want to squeeze in as much as possible out of a small space. Overall, serious thought needs to be given to keeping Lot 2's access to Roblin and reducing the development on Lot 3 to one or two single-family homes also exiting to Roblin, perhaps sharing a shared laneway. The current variance application is problematic to a substantial number of households that currently live on McCallum, Shawmer Dean, Elmvale, and Community Row. It is not right. Other comments? Multiple family rezoning means multiple people, multiple cars, multiple activity, which this small space does not lend itself to. Two driveways onto McCallum at the curve in the street will cause a traffic hazard at times, dangerous now already if someone parks on the curve. The developer says cars will be parked within the complex, but we know that McCallum will become just a parking lot for all these new homes day and night. The anxiety and stress that this rezoning proposal causes as it keeps coming up and how it will change the look, the feel, the safety, and the parking issues has some residents talking about moving before the property values decrease. Is this fair? That this proposal will force people out of their quaint neighborhood that they bought into and wanted to raise their kids in? On a personal note, we built our home on this property after evaluating the neighborhood and loved the look and the feel of the neighborhood and the safety of the area. Had we known that the single-family dwelling next door had the potential to be rezoned for townhouse development, we would certainly not have built our dream home on this property, and as well as the other homeowners of the properties that border this proposal. If there were townhouses already in existence at the site, we, along with those other property owners, would not have moved there. The idea that the city could allow a single residential lot next to us suddenly be rezoned to multifamily makes us feel very deceived. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you. Okay, next we have registered in opposition Claire Nugent. Is Claire Nugent here? Welcome.
Thank you. My name's Claire Nugent. I live at 42 McCallum Crescent. This is the property on McCallum directly west of the city easement next to the property in question. I just want to start, and I want to make it very clear that we as a family and as many voices of our community strongly oppose the proposed rezoning and variances being suggested for 5715 Roblin Boulevard. This new proposal raises many concerns for us all, as it has not fundamentally changed from previous iterations. The sole communication that only some of the neighborhood residents received from the owner of the property or the developer was a letter that was dropped in our mailbox Saturday, September 10th, 3 days ago. In the letter, they state that they are addressing and accommodating any concerns that were indicated in their previous application. They're listening to us. We feel that the owners are not wanting or refuse to hear what the whole community concerns with their proposals. And as a result, this has been a very frustrating process for our whole community. Multifamily units are not consistent with the character or look of our neighborhood and is not wanted or needed in this location of our community. The neighborhood has been developed with single-family units, and this proposal does not allow for the retention of the appearance and attractiveness of the single-family residential area that we all built or bought into. This is not responsible development for our neighborhood and does not benefit our community at all. Even though the proposal allows for two parking stalls per unit, this does not address the parking concerns on the adjacent streets, primarily McCallum, Shelmerdine, and Community Road. Families with more than two vehicles or having visitors will create additional parking concerns. There is no parking on Roblin, and there should not be for safety concerns. Shelmerdine already has the concerns with the overflow parking from the co-op housing. McCallum already has limited available parking, and the proposed driveway access to Lot 1 and 2 will further decrease available parking for its residents and their friends and family. The urban planning report states the vehicle traffic associated with the townhouses will be restricted to an approach from Roblin, but due to the overflow parking that we know will occur, there will be increased traffic to the surrounding areas as evidenced by the traffic impacts of the Shelmerdine Housing Co-op and the vehicles from the housing co-op speeding down Elmvale and Shelmerdine currently. With higher density population in a small area that the multifamily units will give, there will be an increased noise level, which is not consistent with the quiet neighborhood that we currently have. There are privacy issues to the surrounding properties, as the townhouse units will be higher and sit above them. The proposed height of the townhouses of 32 feet is really pushing the envelope on being compatible with what already exists in our neighborhood. The city's urban planning division suggestion that the landscaping may be adequate to resolve this issue is not a reasonable expectation. Any existing landscaping will be adversely impacted by the proposed construction, especially since the majority are oak trees, which do not adapt well to such changes, as we had learned when we built our home at 42 McCallum Crescent and losing a number of the oak trees that we tried to save. Now, I'm not a real estate agent. I don't have access to all this data, but multifamily units will negatively impact adjacent property values. It will drive the number of potential buyers away from us. We would not have purchased or built a home knowing that a multifamily development was to be built next to us. And this was common theme when we went and talked to our neighbors. They would not have moved into the neighborhood if that was there. It was obviously on the owners' minds when they tried to build a condo at where our house currently exists, and they fought that. The urban planning report encourages a full life cycle of housing needs within the community. This need is already met with several life cycle housing in the area, including Shelmardine Housing Co-op, a couple senior complexes, additional 55 plus housing behind the Vassalun, a new condo development on Dale, as well as condos right on Roblin Boulevard, and as you stated, the Ridgewood West development. Sacrificing the look and consistency of our neighborhood by building townhouses is certainly not needed in this particular lot to fulfill the full cycle housing needs. They already exist in our community. The addition of two more driveway accesses along McCallum for the proposed lot 1 and 2 will eliminate the walkway along the city easement for the residents of McCallum and Elmville. This walkway is used by many residents, including students crossing Roblin to school. Losing this access will require the residents to walk quite a distance more to access Roblin, which is not particularly desirable, especially in winter. The variance to allow the driveway on Lot 2 to exit onto McCallum should be overturned. This driveway should continue to exit onto Roblin as it does currently. Lots 1 and 2 do not conform to the rest of the neighborhood, with minimal to no frontage on these two proposed lots. The current proposal appears to be jammed into a small space and is not consistent with the beautiful front yards with trees the rest of the neighborhood has. We need to develop housing that is complementary and comparable to the neighborhood, which this proposal is not. Even though the proposed square footage of lots 1 and 2 is similar to a very small sample of homes, 3 as I counted, this is not consistent with the majority of the homes in the area. Even the homes with similar square footage have a large frontage that is consistent with the rest of the neighborhood. We should not try to reach the bare minimum standards, but at least an average standard. Sacrificing the integrity and character of our neighborhood, which will impact all families in the area, for the personal gain of one family should not be considered. As part of the criteria for approval in the City of Winnipeg Charter, Section 247.3b states that the proposed development must not adversely affect the adjacent area, which we feel it does, and as a result, we oppose this rezoning. The proposal is not visionary or something that enhances or is beneficial to the community. As indicated in the urban planning report and our own discussions in the neighborhood, the proposal does not have the support of the sweeping majority of the residents. I hope the board understands the intense displeasure with this proposal and any proposal that includes multifamily units and single-family units that do not conform to the current standards in our community. This proposal definitely does not serve the best interests of all the residents in the neighborhood. Marty, as you stated at the last committee meeting January 13, 2015, you stated you would not want this in your backyard, and we fully agree. We do not want this in our backyard. Thank you for your time.
Okay, next up we have Barbara Thiessen, registered in opposition. Barbara Thiessen, would you like to speak? Or
yes, I would.
Okay.
I'm Barbara Thiessen, and I live at 62 McCallum Crescent. I don't really have anything prepared because I wasn't going to speak, but I do feel like I have to say something to defend the area that we love. We appreciated that the councillors agreed not long ago, not in our backyard. Then you realized that it would be detrimental to all these people that are sitting here. We feel that nothing substantial has changed in this proposal since the last time that we came here. We went and delivered some sheets asking for feedback. And one of the things that struck me over and over and the ones that we had returned to us was the concern about the traffic. Kathy Ledbrook has given you this photo, I hope you've had a chance to look at, which has the curve that we're all talking about. McCallum Crescent is a very small little street with some cul-de-sacs that turns into Elmvale Crescent. It's not a through street at this time. People don't generally drive down the street unless they're going home or going to visit someone. You can clearly see in this photo, I hope you have it, that there are so many cars parked along the curve that you have to stop to go one way or the other way, often in the morning when I'm going to work or coming home. There's a school bus that goes down the street. We're always walking our dog at that time, and you've got to get off the street because we don't have sidewalks. So that safety of that curve is really in question, and there's no way it's not going to get worse because, as my neighbors have already said, we've got bumper-to-bumper parking on the next street over, Schelmerdine, because of the housing co-op there, and increased traffic through Elmvale because of that. I am a teacher in our area, and my brain always goes to safety of kids, safety of kids. Our neighborhood is turning over. We have our first granddaughter who's 3 months old and a brand new puppy. And we can't wait to be walking both of them safely in our neighborhood. There's other grandchildren riding bikes. There's some kids that are always rollerblading. They're surfing along behind the dog on a skateboard. Again, as an educator, we fight screen time all the time. We're saying to kids, we're saying to parents, your kids have to turn off the TV, put down the iPad. They have to go out and play. This is making it absolutely not safe. I believe that Kathy Ledbrook, for sure, has pointed out the huge variety of available housing. I do not believe the realtor that we heard from has done his homework as thoroughly as Kathy did in the 3 or 4 days that we had to put things together. There are a lot of condos. Ridgewood is going to be the feeder, where the feeder school where I currently work. That's a huge area. My son just bought a beautiful bungalow. It was available on Speyside, which runs off Scottswood, and at the end of that street, Scottswood Meadows is just being built. So there are a lot of available options for housing in our area. I agree with some of my neighbors as well that all the people in favor of the proposal either don't live on our street, they don't own property on our street, and they stand to profit from this proposal, and we hope that you won't take away the jewel of our neighborhood and irreparably damage it with a proposal that just doesn't fit. It's not safe. Thanks.
Thank you.
This is the picture.
Sure, we have it. Next, we have registered in opposition, Linda Jansen. Linda Jansen? Registered in opposition, okay. Thank you. We have Carolyn Alberti? Okay, thank you. Linda Taylor?
Registered in opposition.
Thank you. Andrew Urbanowitz. Andrew here? Andrew Urbanowitz? Yes? No? Okay. James Thiessen. Is James here?
Yes, registered in opposition.
Thank you. Who is that? Edie O'Connor? Is Edie here? Oh, okay, great. Mm-hmm. Welcome. Just get you to state your name and address, please.
My name is Edie O'Connor, and I live at 30 McCallum Crescent.
Okay.
I'm probably going to repeat. I have very short things to say here, as I spoke the last time I was here, and I'm sort of not happy to be here on the same thing a second time round. As a resident of 30 McCallum Crescent, I am strongly opposed to the rezoning of this 5715 Roblin Boulevard, and I respectfully ask the committee for a no zoning change on this parcel for my following reasons. The proposed zoning is not compatible with our surrounding properties. My biggest beef is insufficient parking. I have trouble already on the street. The outpour from this complex will pour onto our residential street and will increase dramatically the traffic flow in our area. Of course, this all leads to pedestrian safety, which is key as well. I'm not so sure I want an increase in a population on a quiet residential area. There will be less privacy, more noise. I'm also concerned about the construction project itself. It includes lots of dust, dirt, noise, disruption to our community. And I'm also concerned about the potential for the decrease, for this proposed variance to decrease my property value. Variances, I believe, should not be granted just because somebody wants to do something not allowed under current zoning. When I built my home in 2002, I had to abide by all the rules, the bylaws, and the guidelines that were in effect when I built my home. And I believe that these rules were put in place to ensure that the integrity in my neighborhood was maintained. I'm not opposed to 5715 Roblin Boulevard building single-family dwellings, which will conform and abide to the same rules and restrictions that I had to follow. And in closing, I believe it appears overwhelming that an entire neighborhood does not support this multifamily condo, so I respectfully request this rezoning must be strongly heard and considered because there's so many people in the neighborhood that oppose it. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think at this point we're going to take a short break, maybe a 10-minute break.
Sure.
We'll reconvene at 10 after 7.
Dobson moves forward, I lean back, and then when he moves back, I move forward to see.
Yeah, we take turns.
Don't you guys usually sit over there? Am I used to being in the chair?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we take you here.
Yeah.
I added one to the end that he gave, didn't give to me.
So, we're going to just start up again. So, just to continue on with those registered in opposition, I have Ross Dunlop. Mr. Dunlop, are you here? Would you like to speak? Please come forward and state your full name and address.
Ross Dunlop, 67 Elmvale. Good evening. I'll keep my comments brief. It's been a long night. So the way I'm just going to build off the comments of my fellow citizens, I won't repeat them, but how I see this is about rezoning. If we go back to first principles, we have zoning for a reason. We have rules that protect our neighborhood, and really the standard, in my opinion, should be higher for those seeking a rezoning than for those of us residents desiring to keep the rules and play by the rules. I really think you need to be careful of the precedent you're potentially setting by allowing residential lots to be rezoned. I haven't thought about this before prior to a couple of days ago when I thought, you know what, I live at 67 Elmvale. It's a beautiful piece of property. It's on the river. I could probably put 4 or 5 units in there myself. But you know what? Never thought of that because I look around at my neighbors and I think of it as a place to live, not as a place to develop. So I think the solution here is two dwellings at 5715 Roblin. And hopefully we just don't get to a point in our society or community where we're all trying to be real estate developers. I just think we're better than that. And that's it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Next up, registered in opposition, we have James Michael Meyer.
Yeah.
Mr. Meyer, registered in opposition. Okay, thank you. And Alana Meyer, registered in opposition. Okay, great, thank you.
Rod
Versha.
Yes.
Versha? Would you like to come forward?
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Please come forward. How do you spell your last name?
Berschied.
EID?
Yes. And I live at 66 McCallum Crescent.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I just want to provide a little bit of background as to why there's, I guess, some frustration in the room and probably a discernible tone of frustration in my own voice. First, let me say this is very awkward. Okay? As a neighborhood and neighbors, we may all keep to ourselves, but we are neighbors. Okay? There's no malice or ill will really regarding the proposition that's put forward. It's simply I don't share the vision of the future of the neighborhood. In reflecting on the future of the neighborhood, let's talk about the past a little bit. In March of 2000, our neighborhood gathered together in opposition to the then proposed development of 5721 Broadland Boulevard. Other people have already made mention to this. Patty and Tim were leaders in that opposition movement, and at the time, the minutes reflected, Mrs. Siniak indicated she would prefer the development of single-family homes as opposed to multifamily ones. Councillor Smith responded by questioning how the Siniaks would feel if there were three or four single-family homes, possibly two-story homes, butted up beside their house, to which Mr. Siniak responded that it's more likely trees would remain if there were single-family homes and thereby providing the Siniaks with more privacy. The community was united in the opposition to that particular proposal. Many of the people live here or here tonight live in the homes that were put forward as a result of those changes. And the community responded in opposition because it was an incongruent development proposal. It was in the center of a residential single-family home crescent in Charleswood. Bill Clement presided over that session, came to our neighborhood, saw the reality, heard the voices of the neighborhood. Council accepted the opinion of the community and the development was changed to exclusively single-family dwellings. I'm grateful that Mr. Clement saw value of single-family homes in Charleswood and accepted what he saw and he heard. Okay, tried to sell me a hot tub. Years later, we once again had to unite and defend those values against an application regarding 5715, which proposed the change in zoning to construct multi-dwelling structures. The community was again widely in opposition. It simply did not fit and was unnecessary given the other options in the vicinity. Council then heard and accepted the value of single-family homes. I thank you for listening then. We're once again in opposition to a proposal to subdivide and rezone a piece of property in the center of our crescent. This time, proposing a single-family home facing the crescent, a multi-residential site facing Roblin, but overlooking backyards on the crescent, and dropping in a group of homes or a group of multi-family homes along a line of what has been established and defended as single-family homes along Roblin and within McCallum Crescent. It was defended in the last 20 years and again in the last 2 years. Why does this pocket of single-family homes in Charleswood continue to face proposals to transition into multi-dwelling facilities? It's starting to get tiring, and thus the tone of frustration, which I again apologize for. The voters in this neighborhood are opposed to changing the zoning for single-family housing to multi-dwelling residential zoning. There's no malice. It's simply opposition about the future of the community, and we wish to retain it as single-family homes. That's all I got to say.
Thank you. Okay, next registered in opposition, we have Derek Harrison. Mr. Harrison?
Yep, right here. Would you like to speak? Or?
Okay. All right. Eric Nugent?
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 Strongly opposed. Not speaking.
Okay, great. Thank you. Katrina Van Vliet?
Yes, registered in opposition.
Great, thank you. Wayne Lucas?
In opposition?
Would you like to speak?
Yes, yeah. I would like to speak.
My name is Wayne Lucas. I'm at 15 Polaris Avenue. I wasn't going to speak, but we've had a similar incident that happened behind the Charleswood United Church. And we've turned them, thank heavens they've been turned down twice, but we don't know if they'll be coming back again. And I've also noticed the same kind of, procedures that these developers are using as the ones behind the Charleswood United Church who are doing, and that's things like leaving the old signs up on their yard and putting the application at the very last minute before the meetings so that we don't have time to prepare. And it also sounds like these developers haven't made any attempt from the last meeting to this meeting to meet with the neighbors and come up with a compromise to make it go through. There are many parcels of land throughout Charleswood, and if the developers are allowed to buy these single residential properties and split them into multifamily, the average homeowner can't compete. I built my house, and I didn't build 7 units on it or 64 like behind the church. So the price of land will just skyrocket if this keeps on going through, where these single family homes can be turned into multifamily. And just for an instance, and it does affect the value of the people's houses that are around. I'm on 15 Polaris, and I'm a fair bit away from the complex, but it's still by the complex that I'm talking about. And my neighbor's house is for sale, has been for sale for quite a while. And these people came up, and they are very, very excited about the house. And they said, but I want to know about the complex that's going behind your house. And I said, well, it's been turned down twice, and we don't think they're coming back. But there's no guarantee, but we think they're not coming back. I told the woman next door, I said, you know, your house is sold. Start packing. It's not sold. I really feel this affects the property of your houses, value of your houses. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who did not fill out a form in opposition who would like to note their opposition or speak in opposition? I see none.
One for information.
One person is registered, or actually two for information, Darlene and Terry Betcher. Would you like to say anything? Or okay, feel free to come forward. Okay, just state your full name and address, please.
My name is Darlene Boucher. I live at 668 Buckingham Road. And I came basically for information. I have been involved in a lot of development meetings concerning Ridgewood West and the whole Ridgewood development, and also the proposed development behind the United Church. There is vacant property behind our house on Buckingham, so we could potentially be affected by the types of decisions that are made here. I guess the one thing I've really noticed is a passion for the people speaking against this development. A man's home is his castle, and it's really not the city, through allowing these types of rezoning, are sort of destroying the dream that you had when you built your home. So that's a really, really hard thing. There's also, and this is a common theme I have seen, is that there is a lack of trust with people of the whole process for the homeowners. If multifamily is allowed and this development looks kind of nice, but what if it doesn't get built? What if something goes wrong? Then does the precedent that you've allowed multifamily here allow something less desirable to be built? Not too sure about that. Just an observation. My daughter lives in a townhouse development in St. Vitel that has a single attached garage and a parking space in front, and no parking on the street because the developer made the streets too narrow to park on, and parking is a nightmare. Okay? 2 spots per dwelling is just not enough. So all the people who said that, you're right on there. I guess I have a general concern about the notification process for proposed developments, and I've talked to you about this before, Marty, when we met with you about the development behind the United Church. It's very frustrating for the homeowners to have only 4 days to review an incomplete development proposal. The developers, the realtors, the architects, the landscapers, they know what's coming. They've got months to prepare their proposal, and that's what they do during the day, and they get paid to do it. But the homeowners find out, in some cases I'm hearing people found out 3 days ahead of time, and they go to their regular job, and then they try to do all of this on top of it. And not only that, but they are threatened with the stress of losing something they value about their home. The city really needs to come up with a better process. I'm very concerned that the developers, while they modified the development, did not meet with their neighbors. Even if it almost sounds like, we know they're not going to like it, so why should we bother to meet with them? You know what? You need to meet with them, and it at least gives them time to prepare. And I guess the other thing that I'll take notice is that the development does front on Roblin, and it's quite low density for a multifamily development. And at some point, I'm pretty sure the people behind who live around the United Church would have been quite pleased with a development of this low density instead of a 65-unit development, four stories high behind them. So at some point, you have to decide, you know, so that this doesn't keep happening to people. Of course, I'm sure they'd be happy if you decided right now that this development will not go ahead. But change the process.
Thank you. So, anyone else here for information who did not fill out one of the forms for information? No one? Okay, thank you. So we're going to, the applicant will now have a chance to come back to speak to any of the comments that were raised. So we've got Ms. Patricia Seniak, Tim Seniak, and Phil Dwoth. Mr. Dwoth, I'm assuming you probably know this, but your comments need to be just restricted to the comments that were made in opposition.
Yes. The first thing that I'd like to say is that I'm advised by the Seniaks that the opposition that several people have referred to for a previous application, I think on McCallum, has in some manner and fashion been mischaracterized. So I'd like to make that comment. I also really don't believe this lot is jammed. It meets the Plan Winnipeg for infill projects. And also that this area is consistent with multi-use neighborhood, which combines single and multi-family in the area, as indicated by several of the speakers that came before you. Further, the development had signs posted on August 31st, front and back, and also in the press and in the Sun. So to say that this was sort of a hocus-pocus situation where somebody just dropped in at the last minute, not necessarily completely factual. We were a little delayed on the brochures that we handed out to the area, simply because we were in constant touch with the planning department and making adjustments and changes to the very last minute based on requests that we adhere to. Safety issue, this facility, by and large, will exit onto a major corridor, which is Roblin Boulevard. Lot 1 and 2, which is slated for family housing and which would remodel the existing home, would have been two houses in any event with two driveways. That would have happened if just one and two would be developed. We have 18 parking stalls, not 11, which far exceeds the code requirement for parking. If there's some spillover onto the streets, that happens. It happens probably in your houses, too, when you have an affair or Christmas or Hanukkah or whatever. The inventory of condos, as referenced by some of the individuals who said, well, there's enough in the area, those are condos. We are proposing to build multifamily townhouses, not condos. And also, the comment was made that it's only family and people that want to get rich off this project are in support. Not necessarily the case. There's a lot of people in the area that are in support. And we've provided a list to the counselor.
I know you want to respond, but actually we have to keep our discussion.
Okay, so so there are, and as a matter of fact, we have enough interest to sell these units to some very fine people five times over. So the commitment is there to take up these units. I think that's, you know, I mean, we can never please everybody, but this particular project and development is consistent with Plan Winnipeg, and I believe if you review the report from the planner, we meet code, we're consistent with Plan Winnipeg, and in many instances, we exceed the requirements. So that's what I have to say.
Thank you. Just going to get you to wait for a minute. Councillors, do you have any questions or comments for the applicant?
I had a couple of questions. One, but you've answered the one. The one was in regards to the notice. Was you know, there was some concern expressed that perhaps adequate notice was not given or the right notice was not given, but you indicate that the notice was given in accordance with the city's regulations, that it was in the press, it was in the Sun, and it was in accordance with what is required?
As required. But I do have to apologize for the fact that the brochures that indicated the changes that were made and the modifications as required by planning, by the planning department, we were working diligently to the last moment to try and get that upgraded properly to where it needed to be in terms of the requirement of the planning department. So, you know, we could have been a day or two faster on that, and I apologize for that. That's probably my fault.
You also, obviously, you know, your clients, the applicants have been here before, albeit a different development proposed. And I'm looking at some of the history of it and noticed that originally there was 32 units. It was 36 feet high. There was less trees, so it seems that there's been a reduction, and the difference, major differences between the first time and this time is a significant reduction in the number of units, increase in parking on site, increased according to what I see in the proposal here as far as an increase in the landscaping, a reduction in the height. What other major differences are there with the proposal that is before us?
More of a buffer between the adjacent properties, instead of 6 feet, we're at 16 feet. And in the case of the walkway, which is not going to be touched, by the way, somebody mentioned the walkway adjacent to the pumping station will be affected. It's not. We're not touching that or involved in that at all. But on the pumping station side, there's 30 feet and then 16 feet. So what we've basically done is we've increased the separation on all sides, but in particular, the east and west side, where there are homes adjacent to this property, we've increased that to at least 16 and a half feet from, I think the previous was, Brian, 6 feet? So that's, we've increased the buffer, and we're adding professional landscaping to create more of an oasis, more of a buffer between the adjacent houses and this property to create some soundproofing, separation, and some audible soundproofing and the visual soundproofing as well. I would say that the increase in parking is major. The fact that we've dropped the units down to 7 to make it far less dense than it was before, even though I read the planner's report and they said that it mentioned that this property could theoretically be supported at 19 units. We're not asking for 19 units. We're at 7. So I think this is a very, very useful project, and I think it's very low density, and I don't think it's going to have this major impact that on safety. I mean, we're as concerned about safety as anybody else. I just don't believe that's going to be a major, major concern with this very, very small density situation.
A couple of questions for our planners.
If you can,
please. A couple times the walkway has been brought up.
Mm-hmm.
I'm familiar with the area. I see the pictures. I see it on Apple or on iView here and or whatever it is. And notice from the documents provided to us. But is this? Can you help us understand? Is this by the pump house? Is this a dedicated walkway? Is this a formal? What, like, help us understand. Help me understand. So I'm making sure that I understand.
Yeah, the property is city-owned land. It's under the jurisdiction of the Water and Waste Department. It is to accommodate the pump house and the servicing that runs along that route there. It's not a formal walkway. It is utilized by people in the neighborhood as a passive walkway, but it is not.
Is there like a concrete path there? Like,
no,
is it a?
No, it's just it's. It's informal. Yeah.
And then there's some talk of the variances. So what, just so I'm crystal clear, or we're crystal clear, what is, where are the variances being requested? Is it lot, all of the lots, lots 3,
right.
Lot 1?
Yeah, so the variances are actually related to the subdivision of the lots for single-family dwellings. Two of the variances are associated with lot area, and that's a requirement based on the special boundary condition. It takes the average lot area of any adjacent property that is abutting the proposed development and determines that the average or the lot area of those abutting properties is what these dwellings should be developed as. However, we look at the broader area, and we do identify that several lots along McCallum Crescent and Shelverdine Drive do fall well below what the requirements are based on the special boundary condition. What they're proposing on lot one is 7,000 square feet, and I could list on two hands the number of properties that fall below that. So we do believe the single family lots are compatible, consistent with the neighborhood. There is a variance on proposed lot two for a reduced front yard. And this is a result of the subdivision. Originally, prior to a subdivision, the dwelling would be oriented toward Roblin Boulevard. After the subdivision, the orientation rotates and is now towards McCallum Crescent. So what they are applying for is to maintain the existing dwelling in its current location, and as a result of that reorientation of the lot, the variance is required. There's an additional variance for an eave projection, and that's, again, it's a setback requirement in relation to the proposed lot line.
And there's no proposed, there's no variances?
No variances
for lot three, proposed
associated
lot three.
With the multifamily site, correct?
Just a question, with respect to lot one, why is there a request for no frontage on that one? It looks like a normal lot. What's that?
That would be lot two. Oh, no, sorry. For lot one and two. There is a portion of the city-owned land, the water and waste land, that does cut out in front of that property as well. So they do. They are required to get an easement or a cross-access agreement there as well.
Okay. So that's the reason for that.
Yeah.
Could you, Mr. Clark, walk us through your analysis and your rationale for the recommendation in your report?
Sure. I think, as I mentioned, for the single-family lots, we did look at compatibility of the block and similar size lots. So for those properties, we were supportive based on that. For the multifamily proposal. We did look at the criteria for infill development in the complete communities direction strategy. We go through the list of the policies, and the development does tick off a lot of those boxes. From a site selection point of view, after that, we have to look at specific details of the development. How does it relate to the surrounding area? Is it compatible? Complementary? Does it fit? And with that, we rely on our draft infill guidelines. They're not council endorsed policy or anything, but we do review it, according to those infill guidelines, and we allow it to sort of help guide us in a manner that will, create a balance between the design of the proposal in relation to the surrounding context. So with that in mind, we did review it against that, and policies with regard to being oriented on arterial roads where there's opportunities for traffic to come in and out of the site at ease rather than disrupt the rest of the neighborhood. That's one of the criteria. Preservation of natural features, that's a huge issue that we recognize in the Charleston neighborhood. And so we've definitely been pushing the developers to incorporate as much naturalization on site to minimize the visual impacts and noise impacts that could arise from this development. We've tried to address landscaping. We are, still in the process of receiving information from them and providing our comments and feedback on what we think helps make this site a little bit more of a fit. We did work with them on getting greater setbacks from the property lines in efforts to allow for more room for this naturalization and buffer. And in that, we determined that a loss or reduction of the units from 8 to 7 seemed reasonable. And the developers, applicants were willing to explore that with us. So that was positive. We've looked at lighting. I think lighting did come up as an issue at the previous application. We've strongly encouraged them to make the lighting on site pedestrian oriented downward to not spill over onto any adjacent properties. Vehicle counts. We did review this with our public works department. They do have a system to evaluate any proposed development. It's a generalization. You can never accurately 100% determine how much vehicle traffic a development will make, but based on a townhouse multifamily complex, the Public Works Department was able to determine that approximately 41 new vehicle trips would be made on site throughout one day. And then they also evaluate peak periods. So in the AM peak period, rush hour, this calculation was determined to be 3.08 vehicle trips in the PMP period, 3.64. Often if there's more than 100 vehicle trips expected, then that's when the Public Works Department would want a traffic impact study conducted. So this one falls well short of those requirements.
Sorry, may I jump in there?
Sure.
When you're talking vehicle trips at 41 the day, is that anticipated? That's the on-off Robin Boulevard into the park, into their
correct.
Site?
Into and out of the multifamily portion of the site. The proposal is located on an arterial corridor with transit service. We do encourage development in proximity to transit service to encourage a mix of uses of modes of transportation. And so obviously that's a plus. Early on, we did meet with the developers, and we did identify that, obviously there were a number of concerns raised in the previous application. We needed to work, constructively in a manner to try and mitigate some of those issues. So we've continued that discussion, and it's been fairly productive.
Mm-hmm. On that point, would you mind just running through the areas in your mind where you feel this application is different from the last one?
Okay, yeah, sure.
I know you covered some of that ground,
right?
If you could just sort of isolate those
right.
issues.
Much like Phil had discussed, so the original application proposed 9 units, this one proposes 7. The original application did not include visitor parking, this one does. the bylaw requires 11 parking stalls on site. They will be providing 18. Providing greater setbacks on the property, the original application had 14 feet from the west side and 6 feet from the east side. This one now is 16.5 feet. We recommended that, that setback be maintained consistently all along the edge of the property. The previous plan had a reduced rear yard setback variance of 20 feet instead of 25 feet. That variance is no longer being applied for. Again, the lighting, we've sort of been able to identify that earlier on and try and encourage that as a design feature on the site. And then the landscaping. Again, we are working with the applicants on a landscaping plan, and we did receive this after we were required to submit our report, but having an opportunity to review it, I think perhaps there is some more discussion that could be had to improve the landscaping that could be incorporated to the site plan.
Any other areas of mitigation you can think of?
That have changed, or that we think that...
That have changed in this proposal? Like height, maybe?
We explored that as a possibility earlier on. If we weren't able to get the units further setback from the property lines, we had the discussion about reducing the height of the units that might be in closer proximity to those single-family properties in a means to mitigate the impacts of the height. I guess based on the footprint of the units, the design is really relying on a little bit more height to make these units more functional and livable. But that being said, I can't be certain what the interior layout is planned to be. We don't receive those plans typically this early on in the development application process.
But there would be plan approval.
There would be plan approval, but again, typically we don't ask for plans that be submitted to provide details on the interior.
Yeah.
Obviously that's something that could be reviewed, I suppose.
Yeah, one concern that I've heard multiple times is that people use that pathway in between, and of course, because of the parking on McCallum, I guess the fear is that people will visit this complex, park on McCallum, and then use that. Is it possible to put a fence for the full length?
I suppose it's possible.
To prevent people from easily accessing that site that direction, they'd have to go all the way up to Rama.
Yeah, it may be something that could be incorporated into the site plan and then be reviewed at the plan approval stage. There are trees located along the property line. We're not sure, where they fall, or they fall right on the property line. So that is something that we would want to take into consideration. Perhaps the maintenance of those trees could be more beneficial from a screening perspective, and we wouldn't want to leave that on there. But for sure, I think at some point in the plan process, we could look at how the fence could be incorporated into the site design.
Okay. Any
other questions, Councilor? Not at this point. I don't think so. No. Or any others?
Okay. All right. I think I'm going to pass the chair to Councilor Gilliam, and
sure.
We'll bring a motion.
Okay.
Yeah, you can go sit down if you like. If I want to make amendments, where would that come in the motion?
We will do that. concurred with the following, and we'll do with the following amendments, or not be concurred with. So the third motion becomes mine. And we're looking at item 4 first, subdivision rezoning, not the variance.
Yeah, I understand. Okay. All right. I'll move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Carried.
That receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Carried. Aye. I'll move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in. I'd like to make the following amendments. One that, I'd like the project to be limited to 6 units. I'd like a fence around the entire project, so along the east property line, all the way down to the property line between proposed lots 1 and 2, and then along the west property line. Purpose of the fence, there'd be a number of reasons for it, but one would be to mitigate the impact of parking on Schomerding, making it more difficult for pedestrian access to the site. And those would be basically my two amendments on this application. I'll have an additional amendment with respect to the variance application. So that would be, where does it go?
It'll go to PND.
And that this go to the Standing Policy Committee on Property, Development, Heritage, and Downtown Development.
It has been moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried.
In terms of reasons, I generally concur with the recommendations of the planner in the sense that the council has painstakingly over the years set down a number of policies over infill development, and this application falls really four square within those rules and complies with our Winnipeg, the Complete Communities Direction Strategy, sustainable transportation, water and waste, the Sustainable Winnipeg Plan. I recognize that it's 2 years later. This application has been mitigated significantly from the first application, and I think that the applicant has done some reasonable work here in terms of trying to make it more compatible with the neighborhood. I would like, I know people are going to disagree with me, but I would like to recognize the concerns of the community. At the same time, I think there's no Solomon-esque wisdom here that we can bring other than to try and mitigate the impact of the development on the community as much as we can. There is a need for housing in Charleswood. I've said that really from the time I was campaigning. And I think that this will assist in that aim.
Okay. That is the motion of reasons supporting. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Carried.
Okay. Next, I want to make a motion.
Forgive me,
that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. I'll just read my little. Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision or rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is considered by council.
Okay.
So I'll entertain a motion then in regards to the variance.
Yes, on the variance, I just wanted to clarify with the clerk, Mr. Clark, the planner, on the issue of the variances. And, you suggested at one point that there could be a sunset or an endpoint on some of the variances.
Mm-hmm.
What were you referring to there?
Well, I guess the thought was that the variances will be in relation to the existing dwelling that they're maintaining on the site. We're supportive of it, given that it is set back from the street in a manner that is consistent with the neighborhood. It is roughly 39 feet from the property. However, if this development or this dwelling were to ever be demolished, I think it would be reasonable to have those variances terminate, and that any new development on site would be required to meet the requirements of the
So without my having to say all that, can you incorporate that into the
small words, please?
When I go get there? Okay. All right. So with respect to the variance application, with respect to the variance, where's the page 3. Thank you.
That's your page 4. Go back one more.
Okay, I will move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
That the receipt of public representation be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
That in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. Does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or a waterway. Is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property? And is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated? And my supporting comments would be the same as before the rezoning.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Where does the condition? Okay, that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, with the exception that we
with the following amendments. So
that we discussed.
So you're just to be clear. So we're talking about the middle lot, which I believe is lot 2.
Lot 2. Yeah.
So that if there's any changes to the lot 2, that the variance be removed from that.
So if that house were torn down, the variance that's been granted here would not carry forward to a new development on that site, mm-hmm. which would force the normal setbacks to be in place without a new variance being granted. So something like
okay.
that. Yeah. That the
all in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
That the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed should you wish to appeal. Information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered. I just need adjournment.
I have a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.
Um